Ladies and gentlemen of this very intimate surrounding, make some noise.
BBC Radio 111 Live.
It's you two.
Thank you very much. All right, The Edge. Larry. Mick. Andy. All right, fellas. Well, let's go. Boulder and Blitz. All because of you.
I'm
Thank you. I'm alive, I'm at the door of the place I started out from, and I want back inside. Wow, what a thought. Doubling, bubbling, doubling. That you should be listening in cars and trains and cities all over. It's quite a thrill, and thank you for tuning in. We went to school in a place just across the town here called Mount Temple. Four of us met in a school. When we were leaving, this character arrived called Christopher Nolan, and he couldn't move a muscle. Only his eyes were just so sharp and so awake. Turns out he's born without any oxygen for 2 hours, I think it was. But his mother so believed in him, that look in his eyes, she used to read to him, she taught him. And then they found this little pill that allowed him to move his neck by about an inch. And then they put this thing to his head like a little unicorn, and they taught him how to type. Turns out he had all these poems in his head. His first poem was called I Learned to Bow. Then he put a book out called Damn Burst of Dreams, and won all kinds of things, literary awards, and I guess he's a sort of a genius. But I just think about the look in his eyes and the faith that someone had in him, that he was awake, that he was conscious. This is called a miracle drug.
Yes.
you very much. Right, what's next? It's a tune. My old man, Bob, was a tenor, and I loved to sing in the opera, and just came from a regular little area in Dublin, but lots of people love opera here, it turns out, and some people live a little bit of opera here, it turns out. Anyway, this is for him, and the song kind of switches around in the middle, sort of turns on itself, and the chorus isn't what it starts out. It's called Sometimes You Can't Make It On Your Own.
Thank you.
Okay, well, I just... thanks to Zane Lowe and to Joe Wiley and everybody that moved over here. And there's trucks outside, there's people outside. It's been a bit of a day, and I can promise you it's going to be a bit of a night. What would Cliff say at a moment like this?
Take it away, the edge.
Hug, please, for the occasion.
a group hug.
We are gathered here today in the name of radio.
And rock and roll.
And lots of other things. We hope God will bless them too.
God has definitely blessed us to be here today in Dublin, gentlemen. And I really want to say thank you so much on behalf of not just the people here at Radio 1, but everyone listening all over the world for inviting us to your city, into your home, into your studio, and for being so hospitable. And we really do appreciate it. And so thank you very, very much. We've had a great day.
Yeah, 700 years of oppression. You can stop now.
You know what? I had a great look at Dublin today, man. I made sure I looked at it with my blinkers off, you know what I mean? And I really loved the space, and I loved the Christmas of the year, and I loved, you know, the clean air and the fact that it just feels very alive here. You know, you've set up Cammy. This is your home. You know, I'm sure you've got bases around the world, but this is where your studio is. This is where your home. Dublin, to you still, means what?
Bubbling Dublin. That's what Lee Scratch Perry calls it. Bubbling Dublin, man. It's, you know, it's an interesting place. It's like it's in code, really. It's not like beauty of Dublin's not in the facades necessarily, though there's some beautiful corners of the city, but it's in, you know, back streets and places you can go and people you might meet and lock-ins and lock-outs and...
Which normally follows the lock-in.
Lock-outs and... That's just people here. Living in Dublin is like being in a band. It is one long argument. You know, you walk across the street, somebody tells you to, see, I've cut myself.
Thank you so much. I didn't want to have to make an apology.
Those days are over. I swear.
Good work. This is such a, you know, and obviously this is your studio, but as far as the people downstairs are concerned, the competition winners, this is going to be the greatest night of their lives. I mean, I think we asked, is this the smallest gig you've ever done? And Adam, you said probably since the Bull and Gate?
Actually, since the Hope and Anchor.
Hope and Anchor, right.
Which was definitely the smallest gig and the least well attended at that.
Right. I think we've got like a capacity of about 20 people here tonight.
Well, we played to 11 in Bristol.
About 2 years ago, right?
No, 2 years ago we had a similar event happen. I won't get into it now. Yeah.
Do you get sort of, I mean, we talked a little bit about the stage as well. You were saying, you know, you need to feel some nerves in order to still feel alive in a band. But today, I mean, you're about to play these songs for the first time live on the radio ever in the world, you know, to millions of people. No pressure, but, you know.
Certainly no pressure. Well, obviously you're going to feel a few nerves because... You're taking them out in a test drive. You don't know quite how they're going to operate. But based on how it's been going the last few days, I'm pretty happy with how the songs are sounding. So,
you're feeling fairly confident.
I'm just, you know, I don't like the studio. This is a place we work here, but I don't like to be in the studio. I like to play the songs live. That's where you found that, you know, find out if they're any good. You got to step inside them, and. So for me as a performer, this is the moment I find out. And, you know, it's funny, it just takes four or five people and you've got a crowd. And the last time we tested out the songs, we brought in an orchestra. There was 40 of them halfway through this album. And it was during singing it with the orchestra we realized the songs were shit. Honestly, just they, because I could tell. You hear it. You can hear it through the ears of the people you listen with. And so this is a big night. It's the first time we play these songs live.
They're certainly not shit. The album's amazing. I've had the pleasure of hearing it already. People on Monday are going to be so excited. You talked about the excitement of playing live, and I was lucky enough to see this band live before their lead singer sadly took his own life. Nirvana have just released a box set. It's an amazing piece of work. All the rarities and outtakes. Were you a Nirvana fan, Larry?
Yeah, they had a really big impact. I mean, I just... It's kind of... It's one of those bands that will go down in history. It's just such a shame that we won't get to hang out with them, you know, and actually go head to head in a competition, because that would have been good. We need competition. You need people out there who are gonna, you know, whip your ass. Okay.
Oh, it's coming. Don't worry. The last 12 months, man, you've got competition. I tell you, give it 2 or 3 years, half the band's coming out this year. Gonna be knocking on your door.